face.
And life after death, that's dealing with the illusion that we have more time than we actually do. And that's the old trick, isn't it? You know, no matter how things are turning out right now, you know, no matter what trials and tribulations you have to go through right now, you know, don't spend that much time changing them, at least not as much as you're spending on preparing for what happens after you die, you know? So the moment right before you start remembering things, and the moment after you leave this place, right? Look at each side. It's black on both sides. I had to look for sources through the years outside of 120 lessons, right? In order for me to figure out, you know, what was happening in terms of life after death. Because when you're dealing with 120, you're not dealing with the book of life after death. You're dealing with the book of life, right? We have business now and here, and we're not necessarily focused on what's gonna be happening afterwards, right? We don't have some elaborate explanation for that, because what we're dealing with is what we can show and prove. And nature really does show us everything, right? Because even if you're looking at like a group of flowers or plants, anybody seen Planet of the Apes, right? Where they find the one plant, and what did he say? He said, hey, if you find one, you find another and another and another, and they're all kind of springing up from that same essence, right? And one of those plants die, you're not gonna see that plant come back identically as that individual plant, but you're gonna see other plants, right? That come from the same place, that were produced the same way, right? Maybe even in the grave site of that plant where that plant died. We're the only living beings that obsess over this because we know that we're gonna die. All the history of Islam never reveals anything that no man could ever come back from a physical death. That's hard to accept if you've spent your whole life, you know, visualizing existence as here, you know, your lifespan, and then eternity, right? Because you're taking the focus off of here, and you're putting the focus on what happens next. All the history of Islam never reveals anything. It's very difficult when you only see time as linear. Those moments, the only real moments we have, become less valued and less precious because we're looking at life as if there were this extension, right? And we're widening the attention that we spend on everything, right? When really it should be here, right? You have to be willing to look at it would be like if death was staring you in the face, and then you have to come to peace within yourself. There's a story of a great yogi who said every moment of his life he felt as if a sword were suspended over his head on a spider web, and he lived his life with the awareness that he was that close to death. Across the street, every time you play with your kids, every time you eat a meal, there's always gonna be a case where somebody died doing what you're doing right now. It's the ego that makes us wanna be that flower that grows up, dies, and then reappears in either this realm or another realm exactly as it was before it died, right? Or as it was in its peak, right? The reality is, if you look at nature, that flower is gonna repeat, but it's not gonna be identical. The ego is gonna die. The ego doesn't wanna die. And as a result, you know, you keep the individual self, right? But you lose oneness and you fall victim to separation. And if you're only looking at life as you, being you, and all your you-ishness, right? If that's the way you're seeing life, then you are very temporary, right? If you're looking at yourself as being a part of a oneness, then it seems like you're a lot more permanent when you have that perspective. Even the image of like a blackout, right? Lights go out in a city, you know, a couple at a time, big groups, boom, boom, boom. We're all connected. We're all vulnerable. I mean, I don't know one person who has an excess of reliable information here, right? The knowledge understanding degree in the 1 to 40s tells us that we don't come back from a physical death, ever. There's no record of it. And you know, you look at the 37th degree in the 1 to 40, and we talk about the heavens above, right? And a lot of people might mistake that for, you know, an actual piece of real estate in the sky called heaven and not space. Time is very precious here, right? We literally pay the price with our lives for our mistakes. Life is the focal point. Not what or if happens later, but what I have the power to do right now while I'm here, and that I better treasure it and treasure these moments, because this is the moment. Not then, here. Get food, get healthy, get a plan, you know, get skills. This is your moment, right now. If you think about the essence, right, like an ocean, right, it crashes, it's all made up of the same thing, right? It's all one substance. Crashes on the shore, little droplets kind of fly off and, you know, go throughout their little respective adventures, maybe go through the whole system, end up in the clouds, come back to the earth. Eventually, after their little individual adventures, they come back to that ocean, back to that essence. And they don't become like an additive to the essence of the ocean. They just become part of it again. In that ocean, right? In that essence. Those little drops. When they were individual when they were apart from the ocean. But now, when they've returned back, they become part of it again, right? As if it never left in the first place. There's a power to knowing in your heart, knowing in your mind, that even the next moment could be the what? End, right? And now is the time you gotta take care of. When I'm thinking about my book of life, and death is emphasized, it's usually used to describe, you know, something negative, like an ending, like a punishment, right? A punishment or something to be avoided, right? The emphasis always comes back to life and living an awake life. In 28th degree, death is used as a means of punishment and also as a means of deception, to talk, you know, deceiving people with the situations that exist around life and death, and getting people to see something or believe something that's not true, right? You know, death serves as a point of manipulation. Our window of time to build our legacy and add on something positive to the world is very small. You know, and it's a lot smaller than folks would have you believe, right? And in a way, that's scary, but another way, it makes every moment, if you realize it, that much more powerful. Life might be the most powerful thing or the most powerful currency in the 120, because the only other thing we talk about is currency is gold. We talk about 39, and we talk about the hereafter, right? We're talking about hereafter. I waited 379 years. That's not a statement that's referring to an individual. These are rough times, man. It's rough, you know, it's rough for everybody I know. Varying degrees of difficulty in maintaining the lives that they're used to, the safety of their families, the plans that they have for the future, right? And on that list of things that we're seriously afraid of is illness and death. It almost seems heartless, you know? You got people that are worried about their loved ones that are sick or passing away. You know, you're worried about your own health, your kids. And then you're looking for what happens after that. You know, what happens after we die? You know, what can we look forward to? How can we feel secure? It seems heartless for one to tell you, well, this is it, right? But if really, if this is it, then that's the most loving thing that a person could ever explain to you. Peace!